up, y'all? What's up, y'all? Thank y'all so much for coming. I hope you feel the presence of God in this place already. We've been praying, we've been practicing, rehearsing, aka pre-worship, if y'all know nothing about that. Kelsey, this is Passion. Ryan, y'all know AJ over there. Casey. Give it up for our crew, y'all. Yes, yes. Now, thank y'all so much for coming out. So excited to see you guys, see your faces. I always say it's so, so good to see y'all in the house of the Lord, okay? We are the church. Don't forget that, okay? Awesome. And if you guys are new to worship, that's okay. That's what we're here for. We're here to lead you in that if you've never done it before. Even at home, I always encourage you guys to practice worshiping at home because it's a safe place with you and God, and it really teaches you how to connect with God. So I really do encourage that before you come here and worship with your girl. Stand to your feet, guys. Come on. Hey. Need that energy. Come on, y'all. Hey. It's okay to have fun. I'll say it later. Ready?
Can you hear it? The sound of heaven touching earth.
want to fill your spirit, oh God. We want you to come in this room, oh God, just like a rushing wind, oh God. Take over our spirits, God. You in this place, oh God. This place is yours. Stay here. Father, I know that you did not create me just for no reason, oh God. You created me just to worship, Jesus. And we will put our trust in you, oh God. We thank you so much for just allowing us to worship freely, oh God.
God. Thank you, God, for this opportunity, Lord, to give you praise and to spend time with you among fellow worshipers, Lord. I can't think of a better time to cast out fear and worry and self-doubt, Father God. Just like in the song, Lord, it's not just words that we sing in a key that we hope sounds good, Lord. It's our heart. And I pray for the opportunity for freedom tonight. I pray that anything that we walked in with that makes us heavy, that we are made light because of your mercy, Lord, that we walk out of here feeling the weightlessness of your love and how we can put our faith in you, Lord. I can trust you. I trust you, Lord. And I pray for every heart in here, Lord, that we can trust you together I thank you for what you're doing today, what we came in here expecting, Lord, and that we have open hearts for your word. In Jesus' name, amen. Hey, yo, can we give it up for our very good looking and amazing musicians? Woo, 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 woo. Go Ryan, go Passion, go Kelsey, go Casey, AJ. Take a seat, you guys. Come on, let's get comfortable. We look amazing today. I see each and every one of you. Welcome. I see some new faces. And y'all look great. So thank you for joining us. My name is Natalie. That's my husband, AJ, on the piano, doing so well. So welcome. Welcome to everyone online. We're so excited to have you and everyone in the building. Avi, who's happy to be here? I could have really screamed in the mic, but I love you guys, so I won't do that. Well, I have some announcements for you. And I know there's an order to this little bulletin I'm supposed to read off, but the Radiant Women Picnic has to come first. It's Saturday, girls! And for all the guys who love women but aren't women, invite one. So our picnic is this Saturday, the 24th. It's at 1 p.m. in Turtle Creek. And I'll drop the location on Instagram because Turtle Creek is quite large. But we will bring some fun light bites and some picnic stuff. But you're welcome to bring a chair if you don't want to sit on the ground. I get bug bites personally, so I'm going to sit on a chair. And just bring like snacks and drinks if you want something more than a charcuterie moment. But I'm excited. I can't wait to see you ladies. Oh, thank you, Kels. Remember, a lady you can invite. And if all the men drive by together, we love that, but just don't attend. So other than that, we do have volunteer opportunities for you guys. This spring, we're really into giving back to the community. We're in a really hot season in the community, especially today. We got some pretty groundbreaking news, and I think this is a great time to connect with others. So watch out for those opportunities in our newsletter. Candace does a great job of doing the email and telling us all the opportunities coming up. So if you aren't signed up with us to connect, come on and do it. And you'll get all this information other than my voice. And then, so we are in our third week of the Money Moves series. Woo! It's been awesome. AJ, you've done a great job. And I know these messages aren't easy, you guys. So I tell AJ, all right, preach from an uncomfortable place. It's been pretty uncomfortable. So when we get in the car, we talk about tithing tonight. So it's going to be so fun. So week three, we have another week after this. And then, Christopher, do you want to be my model again? Come on, Chris, you're wearing ladder merch. Everyone look at Christopher. Chris is like, I'm never wearing this hoodie again. Look, guys, we have some ladder merch that's on sale. Candace, look at her. Look how wonderful. So our t-shirts, which is all we have left, but they're amazing. Hello, a moment, you guys. So all on sale while we get ready to push out our spring collection. You look amazing. And the pants. Wow, what a day. Look at those toned soccer legs. So yes. Merch is at the back. It's all on sale, which is my favorite word. And get you some. Other than that, that's all I have. AJ, you want to get up here? All right. Give it up for AJ. I'm excited about tonight. It's going to be fun. Uncomfortable, but fun. Here you go, honey.
What's up, everybody? How y'all doing? Oh, come on, y'all gotta sound better than that. How y'all doing? What's good, bro? I'm so excited about today. We've been doing some great things. Have y'all been enjoying the series so far? I've been learning so much about money and some of the things. We're gonna have a treat next week, so definitely don't miss out on next week. It's gonna be very informative, very practical. things that you can apply, things that you can kind of take back at home and utilize. Amen. God doesn't want us to just be hearers of his words, but he wants us to be doers of his words, right? And so I'm so excited about, let's see, Ryan, do you mind helping me out? Can you get that for me, bro? And I'm going to get my chair. But I'm so excited about today because we're going to be talking about the biblical stance of money, you know. I'm going to tell you why. Thank you, bro, so much. Thank you. I'm going to share with you why some of the things are sometimes we get a little bit shaky when it comes to tithing and when it comes to the money and everything like that. But I'm excited because back then when I would speak on tithing and when I would speak on giving money to Christ, there was a hard conviction on the inside of me. The reason why is because I was speaking from a place that I wasn't experienced in or that I wasn't doing myself. And one of the testimonies that I gave last year in December of last year marked the first year. Yes, the first year. AJ Washington did not miss a month of tithing. Now, listen, before you hand clap, because I'm going to tell you to clap. Can you turn my mic down just a little bit? I'm going to tell you to clap. But listen, do y'all remember what last year was? Last year was the pandemic. Last year was the year where my wife came home and told me, you know, she's her job may be, you know, doing something else. And then that was the same year that my job was thinking about doing something completely different. And you guys, when I said every single month came alone, the way we budget our spreadsheet and the way we do things, the first thing that we see is how much we're giving to the church. And how many of y'all know the enemy has tempted us so many times to challenge that amount every single month, every single time we gave. But let me tell you something, you guys. December was probably the best year for my wife and I financially than we've ever experienced in our whole entire marriage, right? So now you can give me, now you can give God. I have to correct that. Give God a hand clap of praise. But no, we definitely now we definitely do want to open up the floor. The ladder is moving in so many different directions. We are out into the community as well. We are partnering up with different communities, Austin Center Community Center, Fort Oak Cliff, Dallas. We are giving food out, and we are wanting you guys to be a part of the next. And when you give and when you put dollars into the ladder, it does not fall into, I was telling our team today, it doesn't fall into a vortex. We put the money to work, amen? And so we want to encourage you to give and continuously support the ladder, because how many of y'all know we couldn't do all of this without your support? And so we are eternally grateful. There is a card on the on your seat. If you see a card, if this is your first time here, definitely flip the card. We want you to connect with us. And then on the other side is a barcode for you to give. That is an opportunity to give at the ladder so we can continue doing God's work in the kingdom of God. How many of y'all know we are not in a place, we are in a place of fertile ground. If you look around us, there's bars, there's a liquor court, there's a liquor store right across the street. But I really believe that we are moving in a capacity that God is allowing us to grab the things that the enemy has stole from his people. Amen. And I really do believe that if there is a job, if there is an area of uncertainty that you are believing God for, all you have to do is step foot on the land. Why? It's because God told Joshua, every place that the sole of your feet tread upon shall be given to you. If I was y'all, I'd just be walking on stuff, just be walking on big houses, big territory, businesses, banks, and everything. Because how many of y'all know when you declare the name of the Lord and when he has given you the wisdom and the power to get high, man? And so we are so grateful for you to give. And so that is your opportunity to give to us as we continue to do what God has gave us to do. Amen. All right, you guys, let's get into the word now. Woo! Y'all excited? All right, I'm excited. I'm excited. So we are in a Money Moves series, and one of the things that we were talking about in the first series, for some of you that wasn't there, key points was locusts.
We do not want the locusts to take from us. What a locust is, the word of God says that he will restore the years that the locusts and the cankerworm ate up. The locusts are small creatures that eat every living thing, eat green things, and they don't even last. They last up to 7 months, and they continuously mate. They continuously, I don't know what you call it, give offsprings and things. Reproduce. I'm listening to you and I'm listening to her at the same time. Reproduce. Yes, they continuously reproduce after every 7 months. Can y'all believe that? And so when they reproduce, they are eating every green things. And there are things in our lives, locusts. What are locusts, AJ? Coffee every single day that we buy from Starbucks. Shoes, clothes that we sometimes need to be saving, those are locusts that are taken. And how many of y'all know that God has given us a blessing, right, that locusts have been eating off of our life inch by inch, but they don't come in a big, magnificent purchase off of your bank account, because we can look at those and we can say, I shouldn't have done that. Let me go ahead and try to get return that. Locusts are the small things. At $3.50, are we good, right? So what you saying? All right, so that $3.50, like, listen, those are the things that once they add up, those are the things that's taken away from us. And then the second series, we talked about management, being masters over the things that God has given us. Being masters, meaning you are intentionally going after what God has called you to go after. And how many of y'all know the things of this land God has given us stewardship over? So that means we have to intentionally be mindful of the things that God has placed in our hands so that we can be masters of it. Amen? And when you become masters of the things, you are aware of how the enemy will come into your life and try to steal things. There is a place that you begin to start understanding that, AJ, if you go into this area, you could potentially fall. Have y'all ever... Or AJ, if you connect with this person, you can potentially do some things that you're not supposed to be doing. Those are the things that you need to be master of, understanding what God is doing on the inside of you so that you can be mindful of those areas that the enemy try to push you in that will basically take away the blessings that God had placed in your hands. So that was two. And then number three is going to be giving. And I'm so excited about giving because I've been reading books, and I was able to bring one book. But what I tried to do is I wanted to come from a practical standpoint, a principle that is in that I want you to be aware of, that God is not a respecter person. He is a respecter principle. And once we understand the principle, how many of y'all know that money will be able to flow in our lives? Money is currency. What we have to understand about money is it is currency. It has to keep moving. The reason why I probably haven't moved to you yet is because you haven't tapped into it. And there are channels you are supposed to tap into. There are things that God wants to put into your life. However, we are living in a society that likes to accumulate, that likes to save. That's what everybody did when the pandemic first hit. What did they do? They just ran to Walmart and they was getting what? Do y'all remember? Toilet paper. They were storing up and trying to get toilet paper. And here's the thing. There are a lot of things in our life that we are uncertain about that we try to accumulate because we are depending more on our ability to provide for ourselves than God's ability. When the children of Israel left left Egypt, God was with them. He was sending manna. He was sending bread from heaven. What did the children eat? Out of all the miracles that they saw God do, they saw him split the Red Sea. They saw him cause fire to come up so the Egyptians wouldn't be able to attack them while they was crossing the Red Sea. They saw all these miracles. And when God provided manna from heaven, you know what they did? They still tried to collect it. They still tried to accumulate as much as they possibly could. But the next day, y'all know what happened? So it wasn't bread anymore. There are things in your life that you are trying to accumulate, that you are holding on to, and God is saying, let it go so I can be the provider, the number one thing in your life. Amen? So that's why I'm so excited about today, because we get to talk about a principle that is not necessarily just for Christians. Uh-oh. I bet you y'all have never heard this word like this, because I've been really working on this. So this is what I want you to do. I want you to turn to Mark. Get your Bibles and turn to Mark, and we're going to read the basis of it. Mark 12, and we're going to start at that 41st verse. Mark 12, and we're going to start at that 41st verse. All right, and it says, Jesus sat down opposite the place where the offerings were put and watched the crowd putting their money into the temple treasures. So this is offering time in church, and Jesus set up shop. He's looking to see what's going on. Check this out. Many rich people threw in large amounts, but a poor widow came and put in very, very small copper coins worth only a few cents. Calling his disciples to him, Jesus says, truly I tell you, this poor widow has put more money into the treasures than all the other rich people, than all them dollar bill folks, all them other people. This widow has put more into treasury than all the others. They all gave out of their wealth, but she gave out of her poverty, put in everything, all she had to live on. Father God, I thank you for this word. Bless it. Let it be nutritious to their body. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. One day, I was talking to this person, and we was in a deep conversation. He was talking about all his accolades and every single thing that he was doing. And I asked him, I wanted to just, you know, kind of to see where his mind was at. And I said, man, what's your purpose? He was like, purpose? I was like, yeah. What's your purpose? What is something that God has placed on your heart? Like, what do you do for the kingdom of God? And he said, He said, I think my purpose is to fund the kingdom of God. In my mind, I said, God doesn't need your money. Listen, you guys, God does not need your money. He is Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end, the first and is to come. He is God of all. He created the creation of money. So why would the creator bow down to the creation? That's almost like Steve Jobs bowing down to the iPhone or Jeff Bezos bowing down to Amazon. These guys are the creator. God is the creator of what we see today. However, when we think of tithes, we limit ourselves to the perception of money. The reason why is because there's always been a negative connotation to what we have in our pockets. The reason why it is so hard to give from a place of tithing to the church is because we feel that the money we have in our pocket is ours. Let me see if y'all love, okay? If you made $2,000 this week, how much of it is God's? Hold on. If you made $2,000, how much of that money is God's? How much of the money is God's? Who say all of it? Okay, all of it. Who say 200? Huh? Listen, the reason why it's so hard for us to give God money is because we think it's ours. If we made 2,000 one week, God owns 2,000 of it. That's his 2,000. Now, if we give 10%, 200 of that, how much does God own? He still owns all of it. He just lets you get to keep the 90%. But here is the thing. there is a portion in our lives that we feel that if I wake up early in the morning, every single day, on days even I don't feel like waking up early in the morning, and if I go to work and I'm putting in these hours with people who I do not like, getting emails with people I do not like, not even wanting to do the work that I want to do. I don't even like this job. But every single end of the week I get paid, it's my money. And we get to a point in our lives where we begin to start hovering over what we think is ours. Because how dare you try to tell me what to do with what I worked for? Now, here is the thing that people have a trouble seeing, is because if I'm going to give 10% of my money, what do I do with the rest? Or how do I handle the rest? Or even 10% is too much. But aren't you grateful for a God that asked you to give 10 instead of the 90? Aren't you grateful for a God that said, I am more invested in the 10% of the leadership that is on the inside of you than I am the 90% that you feel like you can do more with? In other words, God can do less with what you think is more. So we get a point in our lives where we really feel like we are collecting and we are doing the things that we are supposed to with money, and there's a disturbance. And the first disturbance happened in the Garden of Eden. Now, I have to tell you about the Garden of Eden because this is so important and it's significant to where I want to lead you into understanding what the tenth means, because there's a lot of biblical theology behind it, and I want to clear all of that up before we go to questions answering. But when God created the earth, he looked at it, and before the earth bear fruit, or before flowers sprouted up, he halted. He did not let a flower grow. He did not let a tree grow. He did not let grass grow. He halted it. He stopped it. Here's what happened. In Genesis 2:5, you don't have to turn up, but you can write this down. It says, now no shrub had yet appeared on the earth, and no plant had yet sprung up, for the Lord God had not sent rain on the earth, and there was no one to work the ground. God did not send abundance. God did not send life to the earth until it was somebody or someone to work it. There are some things in your life that God haven't sent life in yet because you are not in the area of management. And until you get in the area of management, then God will be able to send life to the places that you are at. So the same principle that was working with Adam is the same principle, how many of y'all know, it's working with you as well. So he did not send any flowers. So then God, that was the first problem. Man, so he created man. Then he looked at man, and then God saw Adam, and Adam was alone. So Genesis 2:18, the Lord God said, it is not good for man to be alone, so I'm going to provide him what? A helper. Who was that? That was a woman. That was Eve. So Eve came out of a problem seen in man that it was not okay for man to be alone. So we get that. So then he gave Adam possession over everything in the garden. And then he told Adam, he said, Adam, listen, you can have everything in the garden, but this tree of life, a good and evil, you cannot touch. God gave Adam the 90, he kept the 10. God let Adam function in the 90. God let Adam manage the 90. God let Adam till the 90, and he was going to manage the 10. Now, what about the 10 that God wanted to manage? Watch this. It was the tree of knowledge of good and evil. Psalms 145, it says, the Lord is good and his mercies. Y'all remember the rich man who asked God, Jesus, I want to have eternal life. Good Jesus, I want to have eternal life. Jesus looked at him and he said, why do you call me good? The only person that is good is God. So we know that the tree of knowledge of good was God. But there's a little twist that got placed in it. It says, and evil. Now, this evil thing is what I want to focus on, because a lot of people oversee, or a lot of people overlook that evil as being Satan. But I want to enlighten you for a second that Satan is not the second master to God. Do y'all remember last week when we talked about you cannot serve two masters? And at the end of the scripture, the word of God says that you cannot serve both God and what? And money. Money is the root of all evil. What was in that tree? There was a part of evil that God didn't want Adam to experience. There was a knowledge that came with the roots of that evil that God didn't want Adam to experience. Because now we know that money is the answer to all the things that are happening in this world. Money answers all things. That's in Ecclesiastics. Money answers all things. So there was a part of Adam that God wanted to keep to himself, because he did not want Adam to rely on a deceptive source. How many of y'all know there are things in our lives that we are relying on that are deceptive? And God cannot completely get our attention, because we are still holding on to our job like it's everything, and we won't be able to do anything else without it. We are still holding on to sources that God is saying, I didn't need you to know the knowledge of, but because you know the knowledge of, you are susceptible to getting a hold of the root of the evil. And it is the root of the evil that causes everything in this land to be divided disproportionately. There's no such thing as poverty. There's a such thing as greed. In Idaho, they will destroy potato fields just to keep the supply down when the demand is going down. In other words, instead of shipping those potatoes to Africa or instead of shipping those potatoes to China, they would rather keep the cost at a certain percentage just so they can get more money for the cost of goods that they have. There's no such thing as poverty, but there is a such thing as greed. And it is the greed that people were getting a hold to, or that Adam had, that Adam potentially got a hold to, that he shouldn't have taken a bite out of. So whenever we take a bite out of the 10%, we are taking a bite out of greed. Whenever you take a bite out of what's God, you are taking a bite out of what God has instilled on the inside of you, or what God is invested in. Because the tree, the 10%, the tree was symbolic of the seed. God is more invested in the seed that is on the inside of you, because he knows if he continues to nurture the seed, if he continues to replenish the seed, if he continues to water the seed, sooner or later a forest has to blossom. However, we're eating our forest now and crying about it later. And so there is a direction that God wants to push us in. Because we have to understand that when God is asking us to give, he is not asking us to give from a place of what we do not have. He is asking us to give from a place of saying, if you plant this in me, I will do something greater, way beyond what you can imagine. God says, I will do exceedingly and abundantly and above all that you can ask or think. So whenever you give your tithes to God, or whenever you give God the 10% that is healed, you are saying, God, I trust you with the forest that I am going to reap in the future. How many of y'all are thankful for the forest? Come on, say, I'm thankful for the forest. And so we have to understand that there are two masters. That's why tension rises up when it's offering time. Because at the beginning of the service, we're serving one master. In mid-service or after service, another master is introduced. I can worship you, God, but I can't give to you, God. So God is saying, you cannot worship me and worship money. You cannot worship me and you cannot worship money. So God is saying, he even put it as simple as this. He said, you can either be hot or cold, but if you look warm, I'll spit you out. God said, I will remove myself from what you are planning on keeping. So whenever you hold on to the thing that is God's, or whenever you hold on to the 10%, or whenever you hold on to something that you know you should be given, how many of you know that you are serving a root of evil? Now, here's what we have to understand. Because we sometimes think that, AJ, I don't feel like I'm in love with money. I mean, come on, that's not me. I love God. I mean, if I had money, he could get my money. But I don't have money. I got bills. I have debt. I have student loans. I have some things that this 10% can knock out. And we begin to start giving ourselves excuses as to why we should keep the 10. It's a root of evil. We begin to start telling ourselves, or people will begin to start surrounding ourselves with people who do not agree that the 10th is wise giving, a root of evil. We'll begin to start justifying why, okay, God, I won't do it this Sunday, but I got you next Sunday. You start putting them on a payment plan, it's a root of evil. And it's those roots of evils that begin to start magnifying in other things, or you begin to start accumulating the 10%. Now, what happens when you accumulate the 10%? What happened to Adam? God told Adam, he said, Adam, if you eat of this fruit, you will be removed from the presence of God, and what? You shall surely die. You will be removed from the presence of God, you will be removed from Eden, and you shall surely die. When Adam bit of the fruit, did he die? He didn't die. And that's what happens to us. When we save that 10%, we don't die. And we say, oh, God, thank you. Got you next time. But here's what happens. There's an area in our life that we are picking from the forest that God wants us to inherit in the future. See, the reason why you haven't inherited the forest yet is because you don't know how to manage it yet. The reason why you think that there are so many people that have riches and there are people that are of this world that have riches is because they are managing it way better than you can manage it right now. When the children of Israel was in the desert, when they was walking in the wilderness, how many of y'all know that the land of Canaan was being occupied by the enemy? And what God had to do is while they were on their way to the land of Canaan, he had to get rid of their mind. He had to get rid of their deceitful thinking. He had to get rid of the excuses that they would tell themselves once they got what God really wanted for them. See, there are areas in your life right now that you are walking around, that you are wandering in the wilderness in your life, or that you are wondering why this haven't happened for me yet, that God is saying, I am trying to get a hold of your mind. Because if I get a hold of your mind, I can get you to think like me. I can get you to not think of this world. I can get you to think of blessings, of fruit, of multiplication, of trusting me. And the children of Israel walked in the wilderness for 40 years, which would have taken 7 years, but they walked in the wilderness for 40 years because God had to change their mind about what was getting ready to enter into their hands. 40 years is the significance of a generation. In other words, God said, he said, since you won't change your mind, since you won't obey me, I will be more invested in the seed that you are carrying. So he killed off their parents and he lifted up the seed. Do y'all see how important the seed is to God? God values the seed because he knows what it can grow into. You are a seed. People would have gave up on you long time ago, but God was still there. People turned their backs on you long time ago, but God was still there. Somebody asked me, AJ, why do you deal with me? Why do you hang around me? I told him, I said, because I'm more invested in the leader in you. I am more invested in the seed that is on the inside of you than where you are at right now. God is more invested in the seed on the inside of you than where you are at right now. That's why when he looks at you, he sees what you have blossomed into, not where you are at right now. See, the enemy, he wants to contaminate your thinking and get you to be mindful of the things around you. That's why faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. God sees what you haven't walked into. But God wants you to walk into it until your mind is right. So God values the seed. The seed is in the 10%. Because God knows I can do more with the 10 than you can do with the 90. I know you have debt. I know you have bills. That was a conversation in our house as well. But when God begins to start taking hold of your heart, then you will begin to understand that he comes first. And when God comes first, all the other things will be added unto you. Does that make sense? And so as we begin to understand that God is trying to change us, and he is trying to reform us, and he is trying to bring us into the forest. He is trying to bring us into the things, into the areas that he has for us. We have to understand that we have to be patient while we are waiting on God. See, here's the thing. My little nephew, Zayden, he was looking at me while I was shaving. I tell this story all the time. He was looking at me while I was shaving. And I had the clippers, and I even put him on the counter when he was really young, and I act like I was shaving him. Now, when I got done with the clippers, I cut them off, and I put them at a very high place because I knew that if I would have left him in that area alone, he would have tried to do what? Get those clippers. And I knew that it would have damaged his face. But here's the thing. I put something up at a high place because I know what would once be a blessing to him would be a curse if he get into it too soon. God has placed something high. God has placed something way before your life because he knows if he give it to you too soon, it'll be a curse. And so in the patience, we have to understand that God is continuously reviving us, that God is continuously restoring us. He is continuously placing us at a point in our lives where we'll be able to handle the future things that he has for us. We cannot see it now. It's hard right now. But how many of y'all know the things that we practice? That's why we talked about mastering the small things. When we master the small things, when we move up to the level in the big things, we notice that we are just doing the small things just at a higher level. God wants you to do the small things, but just at a higher level. Come on, raise your hands up and say, God, I will do the small things, and I will trust you at the higher level. Okay, so listen, I want to give you three things on how to become, but first, forgot my book. So one of the things that I love doing is I love to read. I always read like a wealth book, or I will read some about technology or stocks or something like that, and then I read about God. And so whenever I read wealth books, and this was just one of them, I couldn't find the other two that I read. I always give out books. I give out books all the time. But there was another book called Rich Dad, Poor Dad, and there was another book called Real Estate Investing. Really good books. Really good books. And when you read these books, you definitely want to, and we're going to talk about what was in this book, but we definitely want to apply them to our life, make them applicable to our life. But who wants to read something? Who wants to read just a paragraph? Who wants to read a paragraph? You'll read a paragraph for me? Okay. Okay, so listen, this guy right here, he is not saved, sanctified, and filled with the Holy Ghost. Okay? But he's a millionaire. I want you to read just that first verse where it's highlighted in the blue.
Oh.
That first paragraph. Just that first paragraph.
If you study the lives of the great leaders, visionaries, and business people of our time, you will find a surprisingly common thread linking many of them. Long before they made their fortunes, they started tithing.
That's it right there. That's all I want to do. Did y'all hear that? This man said business leaders, millionaires, have tapped into something that was given to the Christians. This man said that millionaires in the wealth of this world, y'all remember how we talked about how the sons of this world are more enlightened than the sons of the light? This man said that the millionaires, the enemy that is holding the land of Canaan, have tapped into something that God gave the Christians. And Christians have a problem with tithing. What I liked about this book, he did not say, in that paragraph, he did not say when they became millionaires. He said long before. In other words, they was doing this thing while they were broke. See, here's what we have to understand. When you are tithing, you are investing into a supernatural thing that haven't manifested itself yet. The reason why it's so hard for you to tithe is because you don't believe in a vision. Or you don't know the vision. And when you are in an area where you do not know, where you do not see, or where you have not tapped into the vision, it is easy for you to pick from the vision too early. Does that make sense? And we have a lot of people that are broke and don't know why. Broke. I'm talking about don't have a savings account and don't know why. But I got bills. They had bills too. And they understand the principle. Do y'all see why the world have wealth and it's not, and it haven't been distributed to the Christians? Do y'all understand why? Do y'all see that now? It's because in the land of Canaan, they have to be given something back because they was managing according to the principle that God was trying to instill in the children of Israel. And so once we start understanding that God have us at a period of our lives, God have a period in our walk with faith where he is literally trying to instill something on the inside of us, I know it may not sound right. I know it may not sound logical, but here's the thing. You have to be more invested in the seed that God has placed on the inside of you than what you can do right now with what you're getting. So how do I become a faithful tither? And then we're finna talk. I did a pretty good job today, I think. How do I become a favorite tither? Number one, discipline. You cannot emotionally make yourself tithe. You cannot say, ooh, here we go. I'm gonna do it today, God, let's go. You cannot emotionally make yourself. You cannot get to church and they say, if you give $100, you'll have a supernatural blessings on the end of this. It doesn't work that way. I'll show you in the scriptures where it doesn't. You have to be disciplined. Here's where the discipline come in at. This is, the book was called Automatic Millionaire. He was so interested and invested in tithing that he linked his paycheck account, you know how we have the direct deposit, and he put the church's account. He wouldn't even see it. So if he got a raise, 10%. That's how dedicated he was. He didn't even want to see it. See how they stealing our principles? We taking all the money. I want to see it first, God. Let me see first, God. Oh, and then you seeing what taxes take out of your paycheck. You seeing it all. That's where automatic came in. He was talking about how he automatically gave his 10%. He's saying, you can do it too. All you have to do is just sit down with the pastor. I'm holding sessions tomorrow now. Yes. That's how diligent he was. See, the discipline, what it says is, I know I cannot see it now, but I am investing in it because I will reap it in the future. That's what he was doing. It manifested into something that he cannot see right now. And to the normal person, and to the average person, it does not sound right. The reason why it does not sound right is because they haven't been shown what God has shown you. They don't have the same purpose that God has placed on the inside of you. So when you make it up in your mind that you want to give, you have to discipline yourself to say, God, this is what I am going to give you no matter what comes my way. If I lose my job, it wasn't supposed to be my job. I'm giving to you. If I lose a person out of my life, they wasn't supposed to be the person in my life. I'm giving to you. And when you begin to start making up your mind to give to God first, the Word of God says where your treasures are, your heart will be also. When you begin to start showing God your heart, when you begin to start reverencing God in the way that he wants to be reverenced, how many of y'all know, or revering God in the way that he wants to be revered, how many of y'all know that God begins to honor that? He honors it. Because if you seek ye first the kingdom of heaven and his righteousness, all these things will be added. Whew, I'm getting happy. I'm going to stop y'all. I may start preaching. Number two is faithfulness. Faithfulness, consistency. Stop making excuses as to why you cannot do it. God knows your situations better than you do. He knows how he's going to provide for your situations better than you do. Stop putting your security in things that has an insecurity foundation. You are standing on an infrastructure that is built by man, and I am challenging you to stand on the infrastructure that is built by God. Consistency. Consistency says that I will not allow the roots of evil to contaminate the things that God has placed in my mind. I will not allow the roots. Now I can identify it, and I'm not gonna tell you you're a root of evil, and you're I'm not gonna tell you that. I'm just identifying, I'm conscious of it. I will discern the roots that are connected to the love of money, and I will disassociate myself from it. I will disconnect myself from it. The reason why that is important is because you don't need anything messing with your future. You don't need anything messing with your vision. It's because your vision is what's going to heal people. Your vision is what's going to save you. Your vision is what is the reason why you keep boundaries on your life. Because you know if you step outside the boundaries, you may contaminate your vision. So you want to stay inside the boundaries so God can be the leader and the head over your life. And so it is the vision that we stay connected to. That is what stems our consistency. God knows what you have. God knows what you do not have. He knows your loan. He knows the student loans are calling. He knows the credit card companies are calling. He knows that there are certain things in your life that you shouldn't have bought in the first place, and he still asks you to give because he says that your problems are little compared to him. How big is your God? How big is he? Or are you still praying for microwaves? And God is saying, I'm too big for that. Are you still praying for things that God said, come on, challenge me. Let me show my power. Let me work through you so that when people, Abraham even told the people, one of the kings said, Abraham, you can keep the riches that your man got. And Abraham said, no, I'm going to give it. Lest you say that you were the one that gave me these riches. God says, I want to be the one that give you everything so that you won't have to depend on nobody. And so nobody won't come up to you and say, I am the reason why you were at the place you were at, where you were in. God says, I want it all. Number three, make room. See, here's what happens when you begin to start tithing for God. Now God begins to start pouring into your life. That's why the scripture, Malachi 3:10, is so important. It's because God says, if you test me in this, I will pour you out a blessing that you won't have room enough to receive. That a blessing gives you an opportunity to begin to start looking at how you are managing the 90. How many of y'all know if you are giving 10%, you got to manage that 90? And if you start managing that 15%, how many of you know you have to manage that 85% or whatever God puts on your hearts to give? Oh, there's a higher amount. We're going to get into that. There is a higher amount. Uh-oh. But you have to understand that we have to begin to make room for God. When you make room for God, you begin to look at other areas in your life that locusts could be stealing from. And when you look at those areas, then you begin to manage what God has given you. That's making room. Whenever we budget, I always find more money than I never thought I had. It's because we are planning to be successful. You can plan to succeed and you can plan to fail. So we have to understand that when God begins to start blessing us and when God begins to put things in our hand, we have to honor that and make room for the blessing we won't have room enough to receive. Come on, y'all say, make room. Make room. The room that you are making for God, you are saying, God, I trust you to fill this area in my life. I know you want to look for another job. I know you want to look for other opportunities. I know you want to look for other things, and that is okay. But there are some areas in your life you need to leave room for God for. Because we can get to the point in our lives where we have the answers to everything. How do I get this? How do I get that? How do I get that? And we cannot live our lives on faith because we are trying to manage every single thing that is coming into our hands. But how many of y'all know that when you give God room, then God begins to show up? Because I don't necessarily think that Malachi 3:10 means that you are supposed to tithe. I think that it means that give God an opportunity to show up strong in your life through tithing. Last but not least, the woman gave from a place that no other rich man gave from. The woman gave from a place that she said, if God, if you don't do it, no one can. It was 100% of what she had. The reason why it is so hard for us to understand the 100% is because our hearts are still connected to things that God is trying to get a hold of. That 100% that woman gave, she gave her whole heart and she gave her whole life. That scripture is so significant because God is waiting for you to give your whole life. Not just 10% of it and not just 90% of it, but 100% of it. Does that make sense? When you begin to give God your whole life, then he will add things to you that you've never thought was there. He will restore things in you that you didn't even think needed to be restored. It's one thing to be rich and go to a house with no peace. It's one thing to be wealthy but have kids that don't even recognize you as mom and papa or as mom and dad. Those are the areas that God not only wants to give you, but he wants to replenish on the inside of you. And so as we dig into this, I'm good. As we dig into understanding tithes, because I know there's a lot of things. There's certain things that I didn't touch in because I wanted to get the question format. But as we begin to start, as we understand tithes, do y'all see how God is more invested in the 10%? Because the 10% is in symbolic of the seed. And the seed is what God wants to see manifested in your life. Stop eating the seed. Trust God with it. Stop eating the seed. Trust God with it. Father God, I thank you for your word. I thank you for what you have said, God. God, I hope something today resonated with the hearts and lives of your people, God. I hope something today just gave them an opportunity to realize that, God, you have the best in mind for them. You said in your word that in Joshua, you said, "For I know the plans that I have for you, says the Lord, a plan that will give you a prosperous end, that will not harm you." And so, God, we thank you because anything that is on the inside of us, God, it does not harm. Anything that you give us, it doesn't harm us. You give it to us at the right time. But even in the times where we feel like we need it and it hasn't been given, God, give us patience. Give us joy. Give us love so that we won't operate in a place of fear or in a place of uncertainty. But we put our whole trust and our whole heart in you. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. All right, you guys. Did y'all like it? Was it okay? It's good? Okay. All right. I'm glad. So let's talk about it. Let's talk about tithing. So for the first time, guests, this is Bible study, and what we like to do is we'll give the word first, and then we'll kind of go back and kind of answer it, and let's talk about it, because I know there are a lot of things that we want to talk about as well when it comes from a biblical standpoint. But before I get questions, does anybody have a comment or a question first that they want to ask about tithing and about giving? Yeah. Yes, definitely. Yeah, definitely. And tithing can't be, don't dilute tithing just to money. Tithing are other things too. Time, like giving God 2 hours and 40 minutes of your day. That would be the 10th of 24 hours, right? Clothes. You know, I touched on the subject of greed because a lot of times we accumulate so many things and we don't give room or we don't leave area for giving in our life. God said that he wants us to be the lender and not the what? The borrower, right? However, we are borrowing and looking like lenders. Should I get that? Okay, you can get that later on. We're borrowing, we're balling on credit, but we're looking like lenders. God says this, that's the devil. That's the root of evil. The root of evil is delusion, is deception. For you to look like one way and be completely different another way. Right?